used to hitting the mid-season high notes. This Mudcats on Deck finds 4 Mudcats on roster and 6 Mudcat field staffers in charge of the Southern Division dugout. Oh yeah, and 5 County Stadium just happens to be home base for the main event. This is the 2018 Carolina League All-Star Classic. The wait is over, I've showed up, let's get all started. Certainly there were plenty of moments to capture for posterity's sake and prosperity's stake, considering such proximity. Performers like Bird Zirk created a flap, stirring up the local nest. That might have looked weird till the superstars demonstrated enough beastly moves to lose their heads. The between inning entertainment could not beat those entering the field of play. Familiar, friendly faces, such as the league's supreme slinger. He began with a strike, then got unusually struck for 3 earned runs during the first frame. Rotation teammate Marcus DePlan fared better down the line. Then where Mudcat infielder Tucker Newhouse came up just short with the stick, he amazed here with the glove. He would go the distance at second base, welcoming the opportunity to play an active host role. So sign me up for some autographs. It was a perfect chance to greet them all, courtesy of some beforehand shakes. Well, the job's half done. But don't forget about Max McDowell, who sat down the only North runner daring his arm. He deserved every fist bump as well as this face to face. You come right out of the box and you throw out 4 guys on going to second base and pick off a guy on first base on opening day.
10 for 10 on the year.
Oh, 10 for 10.
The one that blew the streak was they stole home plate.
What?
And that counts against me, yeah. It was a fun way to kind of break the streak.
It's a weird way to break the streak.
Yeah, exactly.
So walk me through that. What happened on
stealing? We were at Winston-Salem on the road in extra innings. We had a lefty pitcher, so he couldn't really see the runner on third. They're an aggressive team. They had a good runner on third. He saw an opportunity, made a break, and ended up getting in there.
Wow.
Yeah, walked us off. So it was good for them. But, yeah, it was a fun way to kind of break the streak.
For me, my keys to success have always just been I'm going to be quick ball out of my hand and I got to be accurate around the bag. And I've just done a great job with that this year, just getting the ball out of my hand and putting it around the bag, and then infielders making plays for me and pitchers giving me a chance. So
It normally takes three guys to catch a runner, so those guys definitely helped me out. But
yeah, take us through that. What's the key to catching somebody at second base, especially at second base? I mean, what has to go exactly right?
Definitely starts with the pitcher.
Mm-hmm.
They say the pitcher's got to be under 1.3 seconds, or else I don't have a chance.
Oh, I got you. I never heard that.
Yeah, because it's his time and my time. So, and then for me, my key is to be around a 1.9. Good throws, hopefully get down in the 1.8s. And then anything under a 2.0, I should have a chance.
Okay.
So, yeah, it's a numbers game most of the time. But, yeah, it takes normally three guys to do a job, a pitcher being a little quicker to the plate, me making a strong, accurate throw, than a guy making a good tag. Yeah, for sure, that's kind of how you get recruited as a catcher. And so when you're growing up in college, all that, it's always you're aware of that number, your pop time, they call it. And that's my glove to the shortstop's glove. A good pop time, I like to say, is anything under 2.0. But in pro ball, you want to be closer to 1.9, and then really good, it's 1.8. So, yeah, that's a big time for a catcher. You'd like to know what it is. Sometimes we'll go watch a video and see where it's at. Because that's the name of the game as a catcher. Sure, there's a bunch of things you can do to try to have a quicker time, but once you get in the game, sometimes you're throwing curveballs, fastballs, high, away, low. That's where I like to say I do a really good job of just throwing every pitch. You know, it's easy to throw a fastball down the middle, but
right.
Who's throwing a slider low and away, or a high and away fastball, maybe one of the pitchers that got away, and it makes it accurate. So
it's really a chess match.
Oh, yeah.
That the guy on first, what's the ideal stealing count and pitch for a runner?
Yeah, ideal is, you know, we get a guy that's maybe slower to the plate with a higher leg kick, longer arm action.
Right.
And then, you know, in an off-speed count, 0-1, 0-2, 1-2, something we're trying to strike a hitter out with.
Oh, I got you.
Maybe a guy has a big curveball, and, you know, so normally the difference between a curveball and a fastball, your fastball is normally 2/10 quicker than your curveball.
Right.
So you can go from a 1-3 on a fastball to a 1-5, and then all of a sudden I have to throw, instead of a 2-0, I have to throw a 1-8.
Oh, I got you.
And that's where I know as a catcher, you know, you play long enough. Some throws are quicker than others. So I got to get rid of it. It's got to go. And some are to say, let's make sure this is on the bag for an easy tag.
It's fascinating. Ideal time to call a pitch out if you really think he's gone.
We as a team don't pitch out much. Maybe in a squeeze situation, but ideally, you know, we don't like to waste a pitch on a hitter, because in the end, you know, there's only so many stolen bases in a game, but you got to get hitters out. So maybe a fastball counts, you know, is ideal for me when I'm running.
Okay. First start becoming a catcher?
That started for me maybe around 12 years old. I was putting time as a catcher, but I moved around the field. I tell guys play as many positions as they can.
Right.
Even at this level, we have guys moving around, and those guys are really valuable. But then high school, I really started to zone in. It's what I love to do. I thought it really fit my personality to work with the pitchers and kind of get beat up back there. I love the position, and then just grew into it in college, and now I wouldn't trade it for anything else.
Now let me take you back to high school, Norwin High School in Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
When you left there as the career batting average champion.
Yeah.
I think you had a .560 in high school.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty blazing.
It was fun.
Okay, so the bat helped you get to UConn, which is where you went to college. You went to UConn, and I think your caught stealing percentage went up every year. And what I found fascinating was that the number of times they tried to steal against you went down.
Yeah.
Is that do you get a reputation? Have you seen that happen?
For sure. I've seen it this year more than others.
Right.
You know, started the year off really well. And then now maybe I only get a chance once every other game, or maybe once a game at most.
Uh-huh.
My chances have definitely went down, but that's great. You know,
right.
The less they're trying, the more chances we have for double plays. And our pitchers can really focus. So, you know, if it's a reputation, I don't know what it is, but we'll take it.
I interrupt this interview to talk about June 9th, where the man behind the mask tagged out consecutive threats at the plate. Both challengers thought they were safe. Both were wrong. The effort certainly earned him a high five. Just check out McDowell's mitt being quicker than the enemy foot. Then he grabbed a bat and left the yard on this power pummel. It was definitely a game worthy of his prestigious prize pick. Have you felt comfortable here, second year in Carolina? You know the park, you know, mm-hmm. you know the league. Has that helped with your transition and your evolution?
Yeah, for sure. You know, you know what all the road stadiums look like. You know the routine. You know, you're familiar with the coaching staff. Joe does a great job with me, working pickoffs and then working with us before games. So it's definitely nice to come with some familiar faces.
I thought that this was great about you too. Are you playing a long game with us? Because one, you were a management major at UConn, mm-hmm. and you also managed an elite 14 and under team in Pennsylvania, a U.S. team in Pennsylvania a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that's on your radar?
That was a great experience for me, getting on the coaching side and helping some younger kids. Right now, I'm just focused on my career and where it can take me. Then, we'll see where the cards fall after I'm done.
Now, did you enjoy managing?
Oh, I really enjoyed it, yeah.
How'd you guys do that year?
We did really well. Started slow, and then, you know, I got to be around these kids. And like I said, it was a really rewarding experience for me just to give back to those guys. And we had a great time and ended up doing really well in our last couple tournaments.
Now, with your perspective as a manager, are you able to see what the managers here are doing with you? Like Joe Arod, when he's talking to you, you say, "Hey, I know what he's thinking."
Oh, so. for sure, and it just gives you a great perspective of how much those guys really care for you. I think you lose sight of it as a player a little bit about those guys go to bed every night thinking about how they can help you. They put in a lot of time, and like I said, we owe them a lot of credit. So it was great to see that perspective and put myself in their shoes a little bit. So
back in your hometown, mm-hmm. you opened up a baseball academy.
Yes.
What spurred that? You like to spread the knowledge about the game.
Yeah, like I said, I've loved working with kids. I do a lot of lessons back home in the off season that keep me around baseball. It was a facility I grew up in. It kind of gave me an opportunity to get reps in where cold weather climate. Our high school coaches opened it up. I grew up in there. Without it, I doubt I'm where I'm at now.
Right.
And I kind of had the opportunity to take the reins from them, and I've really embraced it. And it's been a real fun experience for me when I'm home, just being around younger kids and hopefully give them an opportunity that I had growing up.
So a great way to pay it forward.
Yes, exactly.
What was done to you, you do for them. I think that's a great.
Yeah, it's so rewarding. And like I said, it gives me a great perspective of teaching guys and maybe how I can be a little better out here.
Now, at UConn, as a junior, I was looking back over your stats. I think you, as a junior, you led the nation in sacrifice flies.
Yeah.
You're a guy who's willing to do what it takes to get the run across.
Yeah, exactly. That's just part of the position. Like I said, my personality is drawn forward. Any way I can help the team get a win, mm-hmm. Awesome. Whether it's with my bat, glove, just helping guys out off the field, I like to think of myself as a guy that's going to be there for them.
Now, also, as a junior, you led the conference and hit by pitches. You got hit 20 times.
Yeah.
Is that a taking one for the team kind of aspect? Where you?
Yeah, I get beat up behind the plate, so why not wear some pitches? I think my first year in pro ball, too, in Midwest League, I think I led the league. It's just if they come inside, it's going to hit me. I've just never really had that reflex, so it's going to hit me.
So when you're behind the plate and they're throwing the pitches at you, throwing a 95, 100 mile an hour fastball at you, you don't blink. So why, when you're at the plate, would you blink?
Yeah,
is that the mentality?
Yeah, no. I like to tell pitchers that it doesn't hurt. They got to throw a little harder. I got hit with 102 in the ribs the other day.
Oh, did you?
I said he's got to throw harder than that, though. it's something. It's part of my personality and being behind the plate. You get hit a lot and. Do you
have a rapport with the other catcher? Do y'all have a kind of little conversation go?
It's definitely a respect. Uh-huh. You know, only so many guys get to put on the gear every day. Definitely say, hey, you know, how you doing? And, you know, sometimes they make a good block, good throw, hey, good job. But, yeah, there's just a mutual respect there. Right. Every catcher.
Never stop and think, man, I'm really tearing it up. Or is it just something, just every day is a new day?
Yeah, you definitely, for sure, you know when you have a good game, bad game. But, you know, the more you think about it, the more you lose focus on the next game, the next pitch. And it's a long season. There's still another 100 games to play. So you like to just focus next day, next pitch. Yeah, maybe enjoy it after the game a little bit, but there's always a game that other day, and that's the great thing about baseball.
Right. There's always plenty of games.
And I'll tell you what, it's a plenty humbling, too. Don't for a second think you don't have work to do. So
Yeah, you're having a great season.
Yeah.
So what is it something that you've highlighted and say, hey, listen, I'm going to work on this?
It's everything. You know, you can get better at base running, catch. I can still improve as a catcher. But for me, the key is always going to be the bat. You know, I really come here trying to work hard with Bobby Bell and other hitting guys, just how I can really help the team with the bat. And, you know, if that's there, then I know I can do my job behind the plate. I'm a pretty complete player. So, for sure, the bat is always the workhorse.
Got it. I just want to say, to wrap it up, I saw coming out of when you were drafted, coming out of UConn, you were called an underappreciated catcher. Mm-hmm. Well, I just want to let you know that everybody that's a Mudcat fan, yeah, there's nothing underappreciated about you. We appreciate everything you've done for the last 2 years, and especially what you're doing this year. You're just tearing it up. And Max McDowell, thanks a lot for spending
really,
the time with
really
us.
Really appreciate that. Thank you.
However, the sun soon set on the backstop's two-year Zeblin backdrop. Since he was sent to AA Biloxi following the high A hiatus. Best of luck to him. Now for more wall-to-all star coverage. The South trailed until the fifth when it forged a 4-4 tie. In the sixth, this ground rule double snared the advantage. Then MVP Joel Booker's single up the gut ballooned the South Bulge to 7-4. A 7-6 victory ended the same way it preluded, with the divisions exchanging goodwill. In fact, the Miracle League contest saw different players escort kids around the bases to their own special celebrations. As for the Carolina Mudcats campaign, it took a big blow when Keston Hearer was promoted last month. Here today, gone tomorrow. That top Brewer prospect aboard the roster toted away a .320 batting average with 3 triples and 7 homers. Coincidence or not, the Mudcats slid in the standings down the stretch. That 34-36 first half record reaped a tie for third in the Southern Division. That was just no running down that number one spot. But it was not from lack of trying, as the effort on this Ryan Aguilar pursuit demonstrated. Roll over and over again. Luis Aviles Jr. leads the club in stolen bases. And another veteran proved where there's a Wilson, there's a way. Because Weston Wilson completed this incredibly clutch catch, promising more heroics on the way. The whole organization is an old pro at Southern Comfort. And I'm Don Fuller, East Wake Television.